My name is Sophie Drieke, and during this talk, you will find out whether it's really necessary to blend these macrobenthos organisms, or whether instead we could just use the eDNA from the ethanol preservative to do DNA metabarcoding of marine macrobenthos.
Well, many of you are actually metabarcoding experts, so it's a bit like preaching to the choir when saying that DNA metabarcoding is a promising method to increase cost and time efficiency for monitoring. Related to marine monitoring, the field sampling involves a research vessel, of course, and we typically use the Van Veengreb to collect animals from the seafloor. Macrobenthos are separated from the sediment using a sieve, and all the organisms that are left on the sieve are put in a jar and preserved on ethanol. Once in the lab, several decisions have to be made, and whether or not species are detected with the DNA metabarcoding depends on a number of choices, with the choice of primers being a very critical one. So first we search for the best primer set that would amplify the highest number of macrobenthos species from our study area, which is the Belgian part of the North Sea. The macrobenthos communities in the North Sea are very well known based on decennia-long monitoring data. This map shows the distribution of four macrobenthic communities, and these communities are actually closely linked to four different habitats in the area. The muddy habitat is characterized by low diversity, where we find at most like five morphological species. The sandy habitats are located a little bit more offshore and have typical a medium diversity with 10 to 20 morphological species found. And then the fine muddy sandy habitat is a coastal habitat and is characterized by the highest diversity, where we find up to 40 different species. Processing of the samples in the lab started with the collection of the ethanol. 200 ml of this ethanol was filtered across a 0.45 micrometer filter, which was then used to extract eDNA. After collection of the ethanol, the macrobenthos organisms were identified morphologically by our taxonomic experts. And after morphological identification, they were blended into a homogeneous soup, which then served as the bulk DNA. All right, so far so good. We have our eDNA and we have our bulk DNA. The next question that we had to answer was which primer set that we would use to characterize marine macrobenthos from the North Sea. We searched the literature and found five potential good candidates that amplify a portion of the formal region of the cytochrome oxidase C subunit 1 gene. In this graph, each primer set is represented by a colored bar, and the mean number of amplicon sequence variants observed per sample is shown along the y-axis. The number of ASVs differed substantially between primer sets, with primer set A, here shown in dark blue, clearly having much lower genetic diversity than the other four primer sets. What is also clear from this graph is that all five primer sets were actually getting more ASVs in the eDNA from the ethanol preservative than in the bulk DNA. But this is genetic diversity, right? So how does this translate into species diversity? So we looked at how many species were detected after taxonomic assignment. In this graph, we can see that a primer set A performed best, with 52 species detected in the bulk DNA and 45 species being detected in the eDNA from the ethanol preservative. Primer set A is a Lyrae primer set, which has been developed for marine benthos. In what follows, I will show you the results for this primer set. Primer set A, or the Lyrae primer set, detected the highest number of morphological species in our metabarcode datasets. But how do these species differentiate between morphology, bulk DNA, and eDNA from the ethanol preservative? This is what this graph is actually representing. We see, for example, that 27 species are picked up in all three datasets. We also see that 49 species have been detected in both the bulk DNA as in the eDNA from the ethanol preservative. This is a high number, and it's quite in contrast with a previous study that has tested this for insects from freshwater systems, where they actually find almost no shared species between the two sources of DNA. Interestingly, we also see here 19 species that are only found with morphology. And this is quite striking, considering that our reference database was nearly complete. In fact, only 6 of the morphological species do not have a reference sequence in our database. When we zoom in a little bit on these 19 species, then we see that 12 of these species are actually polychaetes. And we know from creating the reference database that amplification of the CO1 gene of these polychaetes is quite difficult. So we assume that the lack of detecting these polychaetes in our DNA-based methods is mainly linked to PCR amplification. Another interesting observation was that 14 species were exclusively detected in the eDNA from the ethanol preservative. If we zoom in a little bit on these 14 species, then we actually see that most of those species are pelagic species. They are not collected during our macrobenthos surveys, so most likely the detection of these species is related to contaminant molecules that are attached to the macrobenthos species or to the organic debris that is left on the sieve. This is strengthened by the fact that the highest read number observed for any of these 14 species is 153 reads, which is very low. At this point, we have a more or less clear idea of which species are detected in bulk DNA, which ones are only detected in the eDNA from the ethanol preservative. But the big question is, of course, whether we would pick up the same diversity trends, whether we are using morphology or bulk DNA or eDNA. In this graph, the number of morphological species are plotted, and we clearly see a decreasing trend from the high diversity community, Abra alba, to the low diversity community with at most 5 morphological species detected in the Limicola baltica community. If we compare this with our bulk DNA and our eDNA datasets, we actually see the same decreasing trend. So that's okay. In terms of alpha diversity, we see the same pattern, whether we are using the eDNA fixative, the bulk DNA, or morphology. What about beta diversity patterns? Are the 4 communities that are clearly distinct based on morphological taxonomy also differentiated when we look at the bulk or the eDNA? Here you can see the NMDS plot using the Bray-Curtis dissimilarity index with both the bulk DNA and the eDNA samples represented. So the bulk DNA samples here are indicated by full circles. The eDNA samples are indicated by the crosses. We can clearly see that the 2 offshore sandy locations with intermediate diversity are more similar to each other than to the fine sandy habitat and the fine muddy coastal location. Both bulk DNA and eDNA from the preservative recovered all 4 communities and revealed similar beta diversity patterns. Yes, this is great news. However, we also see that our Permanova shows a significant difference between the community structure in the bulk DNA and the eDNA samples. We investigated whether the differential detection of species in bulk DNA or eDNA could be linked to some of their morphological traits. For this, we divided macrobenthos into 3 categories based on their hard exoskeleton consisting of calcium carbonate, a skeleton based on chitine, or animals that don't have an exoskeleton. We also divided them based on body size, small, medium, and large body size. And we immediately see that the probability of being detected in the ethanol is much larger if you're a big animal with no clear exoskeleton. In contrast, if you are small and you have a very hard exoskeleton, then the probability of being detected in the ethanol fraction is very low. In contrast, if you do the same exercise for the bulk DNA samples, then we see that irrespective of whether you're large or have a hard exoskeleton or no exoskeleton, the probability of being detected in the bulk DNA is always very high. In conclusion, we have shown that the Lyrae primer set works best for marine macrobentos in the North Sea. We have also shown that alpha diversity patterns and beta diversity patterns are recovered in the bulk DNA and the eDNA from the ethanol preservative. And we also demonstrated that it is much more easy to detect all macrobental species in the bulk DNA than in the eDNA from the ethanol preservative. The next step now is, of course, to create a standardized metabarcoding protocol for benthic monitoring. And this is exactly one of the aims of the Interreg North Sea Region project genes. For this, we have conducted a ring test among different partner institutes in Europe to test how repeatable and robust DNA metabarcoding is for bulk DNA samples. If you want to know the answer to this, I strongly suggest you to have a look at the animated video of Laura van de Bulke, linked to poster 123. Thank you for your attention, and I would be happy to take any questions, remarks, or suggestions.